Hey, it's Comics Are Great, the visual storytelling show recorded live every Wednesday at 12:30 p.m. Eastern Time at the Ann Arbor District Library, aadl.org, on the corner of 5th and William in lovely downtown Ann Arbor, Michigan. This is a show about comics, comic storytelling, how to make comics, how to draw comics, how to paint comics. And I got just the guy to talk about painting comics today because my guest this week, only one, because he deserves the whole show for himself. It's Mr. Brandon Dayton of BrandonDayton.com. Gosh, how long has it been since I think it was episode 13 was the last time you were on the show?
Yeah, I haven't been keeping track, but it's been a while.
I think it was episode 13, the one we did on swears. I think
that's
probably true.
Because
that was the last one we did before I took the show to the Ann Arbor District Library, and it's kind of tough to get you on now because you got a day job at Safeway bagging groceries, right? No. No, your day job is working for EA Games, yes? What do you do?
What do you do
at EA Games?
I'm a general concept artist, so do a lot of concepting of buildings, environments. I get to do characters. I do some Flash work. I'm currently doing quite a bit of Flash and Flash animation for our upcoming Facebook game. So,
I didn't know that.
Yeah.
So what kind of things are you animating, like cutscenes or like actual like character movements for the game?
Well, it's for a Facebook game. It's the name of the game is Risk Factions for Facebook, releasing very soon. And so it's a lot of there's some in-game animation I've been doing, a lot of I don't know what you'd call it, but just a little. We have a bunch of little kind of Easter egg type things in there, just fun little like illustrations and gags and things. So a lot of stuff like that. Some UI design and creation. That's the UI is user interface. So, but I work with a bunch of other really great artists working on the game. So, we are doing some. Maybe we will do some cutscene stuff if we get a chance. So,
yeah,
been a really interesting mix.
Huh, interesting. Like, so, Risk, I mean, I'm guessing it's going to be a little bit one of those, like, map games, like the Smurfs game for the iPhone. I don't know if you've seen that, where it's, like, basically, like, build a little Smurf village and harvest crops and grind through these different cycles to get more Smurf berries so you can get more special things, right?
It's kind of a hybrid game as far as Facebook games are concerned. It has some of the... If you're familiar with Facebook games, it has some of the traditional tropes that go along with Facebook games, the city building stuff you're talking about, where you have to build a base and you have resources and you harvest resources in certain ways. But the real core of the game is kind of the core Risk game. And I think that game is the design we put into that is just very, very tight. There's PvP in it too, which I really like. You can, you know, play against other people, you can play against friends, which is kind of rare in the Facebook area. But it also has kind of a really cool like sense of humor and feel to it. So it's kind of a tongue-in-cheek look at you know, kind of that Risk genre. So you have, it's called Risk Factions because you have different armies you can play with. You have like the Napoleonic faction, you have you know, cats, you have zombies, and then you have other factions that you'll unlock as time goes on. So
I wanted to take one step back before we talk about digital painting and talk a little bit about like how you say you're a concept character designer. You know, one of the things that I get asked a lot by parents after I lead a workshop series for teens or, you know, even kids, they're like, what does my kid got to do to have a career as an illustrator? I mean, because then they all have that look of terror in their eyes, right? Because like, oh man, I don't want them to be a freelancer. I want them to actually have an insurance package, and I want them to be, you know, have a real job with real benefits, kind of thing.
Uh-huh.
And to which I assure them, like, well, you can do that and be a freelancer too. But one of the things that a lot of parents don't get, and I think also young people don't get, is what their opportunities are in the world of illustration in general. And you know, there's this thing called character design for video games. I mean, what could you describe just like in a nutshell what that job entails? Like, what skill sets do you have as a cartoonist, as a comic book artist, that apply to this?
Yeah, well, first of all, it's a changing world. It really, we grew up in a world where our parents were terrified with the idea of us being artists, and that I'm sure that those attitudes still exist. But the world has really changed. There are a lot more opportunities for artists out there than there ever were, and there are paying jobs with benefits and salaries and things for artists like that. And games is a big, big part of that. So, you know, thank God for video games that, you know, there's such a need for artists. So, as a concept artist for people that are interested in looking into that field, you know, I really recommend, or I guess the thing that comes from comics that's helpful or that crosses over is, you know, the bulk of work you're going to be doing or that is needed is going to be concepting props and environments and buildings and things like that. So if you can have a strong foundation in technical drawing and in color and in painting, then that's very, very helpful. I'm able to do the character work because I already have my foot in the door doing the other things, and I'm able to do the other things. And then, you know, once you do get those opportunities to do characters and monsters and robots and fun things like that, you know, you can do that type of stuff.
So you got to kind of earn your stripes through the system, like any like real job, right? You got to work your way up.
I don't know if it's a matter of working your way up as much as just kind of fulfilling the primary needs of the game design world. And the primary needs of the game design world are not characters. It's kind of like doing the work that they need 90% of the time so you can do the stuff that's fun that 10% of the time.
Designing assets. I just got a freelance gig doing some assets for games. And what were those assets? Oh, could you draw a bed? Could you draw a dresser? You know, it's like not the glamorous things you think. Like, could you design like you were saying, like a monster or a robot for our game? No, it's, you know, it's a good pile of socks on the floor.
Yeah, and that type of stuff, sometimes when you get into that, you can be like, oh my gosh, like this is, I should be, you know, designing characters for Pixar. Why am I designing socks? But, you know, all of that stuff makes you a better artist. Like learning how to do that stuff makes you a better artist, especially if you can learn to approach that and say, hey, what's the personality of socks lying on the floor?
Right.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, that's where we get lost in this stuff, right? Oh, is this a pile of socks where it's like, oh, it just fell out of the laundry basket and they're actually clean and they're rolled up? Have they been there for weeks? You know, were they worn for weeks before they were thrown on that pile of the floor? Man, there's a lot of questions to answer just with that.
Yeah. You know? Everything should have a personality and everything should have an attitude. And it's kind of lazy artist that's just kind of like, oh, socks, and just kind of going at it. So you need to find kind of the way to make that thing cool and make that thing fun. But yeah, it makes you a better artist. And the thing is, like Pixar has loads of people just drawing socks and lampshades and stuff like that. So you need to know how to do that stuff and do that stuff with personality and make it fun.
I like that you put in that word lazy. Like you have to care about all that stuff too, right?
Yeah.
So, yeah. Okay. Well, I wanted to isolate this and highlight this for any young artists who want to convince their parents why they should send them to art school. That here's 1 minute of talking between two guys about how there's job opportunities out there, if you care. The other thing I wanted to talk to you about today, and I want to get to this first, and then if we have time at the end, talk a little bit about micropayments, because that's something that you've been messing around with a lot lately, and it's fascinating to watch your website. And I want to get some input on you and how it's been going. But So I tried a digital painting last night, and I'm wondering if the guys running the technical boards can pull it up on the screen. Brandon, you already saw it, but you won't see this as they pull it up on the screen. I tried to do – there we go. It's oh, boy. It was brutal. I sat down and one of the things I wanted to do was I wanted to – with this new comic relaunch that I'm playing with, I was thinking, wouldn't it be cool to do a series of matte paintings that I can repurpose throughout the book and borrow from the animation playbook of, yeah, here's like – I'm thumbnailing the book. I'll find some key scenes that I can do one painting of and then repurpose it. It'll make the work go faster, and plus it'll look more like animation, which is what I'm trying to do. So I tried my hand at digital painting. And then after an hour and change, I looked at it and went, oh, this is awful. How does Brandon do it? Because then I went to BrandonDayton.com and went to some of the things that are in your portfolio. And oh my gosh, night and day. So I'm wondering if we can get like some thoughts on digital painting. Like, first of all, what did I do wrong with this piece?
Well, you know, it's actually, I wouldn't say what you did wrong, because it's like I said, it's a very good start. And you may kind of chuckle and say like, oh, that's a very nice way of saying it's not very good. But, you know, it shows that you have a foundation, which is good. Let's see. I wasn't really thinking about doing a critique, but
You don't have to. You don't have to. I'm just kidding around. But one of the things that, you know, see, I've done cel-shaded style coloring in my comics for a while, and I think I'm okay at that. But this is a whole new frontier. Like this whole idea of, like, first of all, I never really did traditional painting. you know, in my art studies. So that's where I'm kind of at a loss. And then also this idea of, like, how do you modify brushes and how do you use the brushes? That's the kind of thing I'm hoping we can get from you today.
Okay.
Is, like, maybe we could get a walkthrough of how you approach digital painting. And that's this is where I'm going to have to throw a disclaimer for those listening in the audio. If you're listening to this podcast after the fact, I'm sorry, but, you know, it's a video show too, so this might be one where you want to watch the video, because we're going to be – and I'll do my best to describe what Brandon's doing, as I'm sure Brandon will, but you'll probably benefit more from watching the actual video of this episode, which you'll find at comicsaregreat.com/CAG41. That'll be the easy place to get all the links to the stuff that we're talking about today. So anyway, Brandon, do we want to try doing a screen share?
Yeah, let me switch it to screen share. We'll get going on this.
I should say that one of the inspirations for this discussion too, when Brandon sets this up, is Brandon did a workshop for leanintoart.com last month, Foundations of Dynamic Line Work. And oh my gosh, it got me thinking so hard about how I approach line value in my comics. And watching Brandon work on the screen as he was describing how he approaches line work was absolutely amazing to behold. So I have high hopes for this demo.
There we go.
Okay, it's still thinking about it on my end. Just give Skype a chance to...
Give us a second.
There we go. We've got Photoshop up on the screen. And which version of Photoshop are you using? Not that it matters.
I'm using CS5. So the one thing you'll notice that'll probably be unique to CS5 as opposed to earlier versions is I'm going to probably do some screen rotation.
Oh, is that only in 5? I thought that was in 4 too.
It starts in 4.
Okay.
So... yeah, so if you have CS4, you could probably be doing screen sharing as well. So let's see. I'm just going to jump in and kind of just start sketching, doing kind of a digital sketch, and just kind of see where that goes. May very well be disastrous. That's happened before, but it may end up being cool too. So it's kind of like watching theater. You know, part of the fun of watching theater is the chance that someone's going to just totally mess up.
Totally, yeah. That's the fun of doing a live show like this.
Yeah. Okay, so I'm just going to kind of start with knocking a gradient here just to give me a start. So let me kind of start with talking about, in general, what my approach is when I do digital painting. This kind of approach to digital painting is one kind of standard approach I use quite a bit. And its roots kind of come from the very first illustrations I did were actually a lot of Illustrator. So I did a lot of Illustrator work early on. And as I was doing Illustrator work, I felt like I wanted something that was more, had more texture to it. So the way you're going to see me working here is I'm going to kind of work as if I was an Illustrator, using a lot of flat shapes, layering them on top of each other. Then kind of once I've layered those shapes on, then I want to go in and start adding texture and adding shadow to them. So I'm just going to start blocking in some shapes here and, try to kind of figure out what I want to draw here. I mean, maybe I'll do some sort of monster, kind of a
monsters are always a nice, easy one to...
Yeah. Don't have to think about it too much.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Just fun shapes. What kind of brush are you using? Are you using the brush? Yeah, you are using the brush tool, I see.
Yes, so I'm using stylus right now. You right click with your stylus, you can bring up all of your brushes. So that's kind of one way to quickly choose brushes. I'm using a chalk brush, kind of just a standard chalk brush. And this is so I can block out my shapes. And I use this because I like the texture it gives me. It isn't too clean, but still gives me a good hard edge. And so just as a quick note, if you kind of look here on my brush palette on the left, I don't know, it's kind of small to see, but there are three or four standard brushes. There's a marker brush, there's an airbrush, there's kind of a hard tapered brush. And those are one of the good ways to think about digital painting is really those four or five brushes are all you really need to do digital painting. Especially as far as rendering, as you get into adding texture, you may want to start using some other brushes and some custom brushes, and I can show you some of the custom brushes that I've used to do that as we go.
So now what you've done is you've blocked out the shape with the brush strokes, and then you go in with the lasso tool and then fill in the entire shape.
Yeah, and that may be – I'm doing that right now. I haven't always done it that way, but that'll work for right now. So.
And so now you're going around and cleaning up the outside of the shape with.
Yeah,
like, the
I'm just kind of. I'm still kind of playing with the shape. I kind of know that I want to do some sort of face, and so I'm kind of just playing with the silhouette and trying to kind of create an interesting silhouette.
This goes back to something Krishna Sadasivam talks about a lot, is working from a really good silhouette for your character, sculpting your character from the silhouette first rather than from the lines.
Yes. And it's a different approach than when I'm drawing, I always start with line. I always scribble, and if I'm designing a character with lines, I'll start with scribbles. So this is kind of a little bit more of a risky. So I'm adding another layer here, gonna add some sort of neck shape in. And
how many layers do you typically wind up having for a digital
millions?
So you got a lot of RAM on your machine, do you?
Yeah. I kind of approach things in such a way that it makes it necessary for me to have a good computer. I like working in really large file sizes and. Okay, so I'm trying to think of what I want to do here now. Let me add in some eyes here.
So now you're gonna paint right over top of this color.
Yeah, I'm gonna actually create a separate layer for the eyes now.
Okay, now this is interesting. So you're using the paintbrush. So there's some aliasing going on with the edges of the lines, right? Like what Photoshop does when it replicates like a more natural look. So you don't have that exact hard edge of like the pencil tool.
Yes. So I wouldn't call it aliasing. Because it's still, I mean, technically it has anti-aliasing going on.
Oh, anti-aliasing, that's what I meant to say. Sorry.
So, but it's going to have texture to it. So, yeah, I don't want a totally clean line. I want to have something that's going to have a little bit of pop to that. And along those same lines, so I've got the brush I'm using now is kind of a tapered brush, but it's a tapered brush built out of a chalk brush. So that along the same lines, it's going to have a little bit of something. And I can even go into my brush my brush presets here. And this is kind of your tool that you can use for kind of changing your brush around. If you go up to brush tip space, wait, actually don't want to do brush tip space. I'm going to go to shape dynamics and let's see, I want to kind of rotate it a little bit. Is that actually in scattering? That might be in scattering.
Yeah, we should say in the later versions of Photoshop, but this may have been even in like the first CS version, there's this whole brush palette now where you can change the shape dynamics, meaning you can change the amount of tapering that happens on the brush stroke. And especially if you have like a digitizer tablet, like a Wacom tablet, you can set that to respond to the pressure sensitivity. So the line will get thicker if you press harder. You can set a scattering to it to where the line will actually wobble and shake more depending on the amount of pressure, or you can also set like percentages, like wobble it this much. You can add a texture to the line. You can there's even more in here that I don't even know what they really do, like transfer or color dynamics.
Yeah, transfer does a lot of your opacity stuff now. If you want there to be an opacity in the actual brush, transfer will do that. Color dynamics I don't really use. So now I kind of just played with this brush a little bit. I'm going to blow it up so you can kind of see. Now that the brush I have kind of has some texture to it.
Okay.
You may not even pick that up, but I did that just by doing a tiny bit of scattering and then a little bit of angle jitter on it. And none of that is controlled by brush sensitivity, but...
pressure sensitivity?
No, yeah, it's not controlled by brush, but yeah, by pressure sensitivity. It's just kind of going to be... kind of natural in the brush. So yeah, still want to do something more with this nose here.
Going more into making the silhouette a little bit more strong.
Yeah, so I'm just going to kind of keep playing with the silhouette. And that's kind of a lot of the way I work too, is just playing around with something until, you find something interesting. And I'm still really just establishing shapes here. So, I'm going to try to keep this as simple as possible, but just to get around this stuff. So I'm not going to put too many other flat shapes on here. Normally with something like this, where I have a very detailed, someone wearing clothes and jewelry and all sorts of stuff like that, I'm going to end up with just all sorts of layers. Every single kind of thing is going to be a layer. I'm going to give them kind of the necklace type thinging, maybe.
So you start with the lines again.
Yes.
You draw this necklace thing on a new layer.
Yeah. Yes, keeping that all separate. And that's going to allow me to go in and play around with color too later as I kind of like try to fix this palette. I'm trying to do a little bit of different palette than I normally do. So I can go in here and hit Command-U. Let me pull this palette up. This is, you know, your hue and saturation, and I'll use this to kind of play with
Oh, interesting. Color. So you can just do it by layer. So, okay, so what you've done is you have this monster's head on one layer,
yeah.
The neck on another layer, and you just
yeah.
select that layer, then go to hue saturation by either Command or Control-U, and you can monkey with the color just without having to do any kind of select. You don't have to do a select all. You don't
yeah.
have to use your magic wand tool. You just select whatever's on that layer. Interesting.
The other thing that's kind of quick I do is you'll notice there's this little checkerboard thing, the lock transparency thing.
Yep.
So I'll use that a lot too. Just I want to put in – I'm changing this color on the neck too. And so you can just hit that and hit fill, and that'll fill that.
Right. So in your layers palette, you can click lock transparent pixels, and then you can just do like a general fill on whatever's on that layer, and all fill with that color, and it won't fill anything outside of that color. Now here's my question.
Mm-hmm.
Do you have any problems with the anti-aliasing around the edges of these shapes?
No, I don't. I mean, that may be part of just kind of, you mean kind of how this looks here?
Yeah, like it's not, because it does the anti-aliasing, now it's going to have an even harder edge, isn't it? Because it's filling in some of the anti-aliased pixels.
No, it's not, because this isn't a selection. This is locking the transparency. So if I have, let me kind of show you here. I can now go onto the shape and I'm going to go in close on this corner of his head. You know, I airbrush. Well, I gotta unlock it. Oh, there we go. Whoops. Okay.
So
see how I airbrushed his head there?
Uh huh.
All right. Now I'm gonna go in. I'm gonna lock the transparency on that. Change it to a darker color. And you'll see that it preserves that edge there.
What? So, wow! I have not messed with that recently. So, like in later Photoshops, it's handling it a little bit better, isn't it?
Yeah. So you don't. I can change this color a million times, and it's gonna preserve that edge as long as I have that lock transparency. Now, if I did a selection, it would be different. A selection is gonna start, you know, doing all sorts of weird things and starting to create really chunky lines and messing with your anti-aliasing. So, but as long as you have your lock transparency going, you should be okay on that. So,
okay. So what next? You got this all blocked out.
Okay, I'm just going to play. I should be more kind of like methodical with this, but...
No, we're just goofing around. This is a casual show.
I'm just going to play with the background just a little bit. And...
So you jump back and forth between your layers while you're working.
Yeah. Probably shouldn't do that too much, but if I'm in a real rush, then I got to be a little bit more... Okay. Yeah, I don't like that.
This is what we call heuristic drawing, isn't it?
That's the process. Okay, so let's see. I want to figure out. No, I'm gonna start going in now and just adding in some line work to it. So I'm just gonna grab the same purple color, go a little bit darker, create a new layer, for it.
Yep, I was wondering.
And. Just kind of draw on top of it. And this is just what I'm going to be doing here. Just the work's the same as doing any kind of, you know, ink line work. I just want to create some interesting lines. If possible.
So you're just inking over top of the shape illustration. Now, for those who aren't watching the video, even for those who are watching the video, we're watching you rotate the canvas on the fly. And this is a new thing in the later Photoshop CS suites, this rotate feature. What hotkey does that have?
That is R rotates, and then you hit escape to bring you back to ground zero, whatever.
Yeah, so like in the old days, going back to like Photoshop version 3, you could rotate canvas by an arbitrary amount, like by 15%.
Yeah,
but
you have to go into a palette and like select it, and yeah.
But this is actually like rotating it, but like remembering that you haven't actually rotated the image. It's sort of just like doing this,
yes.
this virtual rotation. And then when you hit escape, it just like sets it right back to normal, to the original orientation, which is super, super cool. Okay, so now you're throwing on some detail lines around the nose and the eyes, just drawing over top of this shape.
Yeah.
And this is going to give you some clues as into the geography of this guy's face, so you can start applying light and shadow.
And I'm trying to figure out what I want to do with the mouth. I'm not totally sure. Okay. That could be interesting.
So we get getting a question from the chat. Ray Benia. Okay. I find that a lot of artists with a line-based style tend to have problems when switching to a mass-based painting style. Your style translates fantastically. Did you have to get over any hurdles when switching to digital painting?
You know, it's just a different approach. I guess you have to think about it differently. But yeah, certainly. I'm not sure how to answer that.
Well, I think when we watched you start, you started with a line-based thing, and then you filled it in, and then started sculpting the silhouette from that. So you started from what a lot of line-based illustrators would find as a natural beginning point.
Yes.
Right?
Yeah, I don't see too much different in the two of those. I understand that there's kind of some different ways to look at it, and I try to look at all my stuff in kind of the same way. I do always, even when I'm doing line work, I try to think of things in terms of masses, especially when you get into coloring. I mean, really, when you're doing like a tune shaded thing, it's really the same kind of principles as go into painting something. The only difference when you're like rendering something more fully is you're just going to take some more time and kind of having a variety between your soft and your hard edges. I mean, tune shaded stuff is all hard edges. Mm-hmm. Now, when you get into doing more of stuff like this, then you kind of need to think more about soft edges, hard edges, and where they're soft edges, where you have hard edges. So, which is a good point for us to go to, because I'm going to start putting in some shading here now.
Now, this is what I've been waiting for.
I'm going to do another kind of change on the color here, just because I think the shadow is going to, I'm going to want a little bit, I'm going to make his face a little bit warmer. Warm means that it has more oranges, yellows in it. Cool means it's more bluish. So one thing to think about as you're doing shading is usually your light area and your shadow area are going to be
opposite temperatures.
Yes. So you have your warm on one side, you have your cool on the other side, and usually it's cool shadows. Warm light, but you can also do warm shadows, cool light.
Right, like all those cop procedural shows where everything is always lit green. Everything is lit green.
Yeah.
Every time I turn on broadcast television, if it's a drama, there's green lighting going on everywhere. And so, what would be the shadow you'd choose for a green lit room?
Huh, that's very interesting. I guess it would be kind of warms. I mean, you're gonna want, because it is gonna be kind of relative. I'd have like. Something with you know, something complementary, I think.
Yeah, so like I would probably want it going into like a reddish purple kind of color.
Just kind of a very standard glossy concept art. Okay, I'm trying to find a brush to kind of do the shadows here. Again, with the shadows, this is really the same as if you're going to tune shade something. And just as a note here, you notice I've got this layer. I don't know how well you can see this. I've got a layer above the face layer. If you put your cursor between two layers and hold down, I think it's Option, creates this little icon that's two circles overlapping each other. That basically creates a clipping layer out of the layer underneath.
Okay, I've heard about this, but I have not used it yet. So what does a clipping layer do?
So a clipping layer basically does the same thing as preserve transparency, but it also gives me a separate layer. It gives me all of the shadow that I'm putting in right now is on a separate layer.
Oh, for crying out loud.
So I can just kind of color over. And so you notice now when I pop it out, you know, it uses the layer underneath kind of to mask it out.
So it's using the layer beneath it. So like for those who are, you know, it's kind of difficult to see on the stream, the high-res video later will look better. You'll probably be able to see this. But in the layers palette, there's a layer above the layer with the shape of this guy's head. And it seems the preview, there's always a preview icon in the layers palette. It's a little bit offset to the right with a little arrow pointing down beneath it up to its left. And so this layer is behaving like when you, it's observing the shape below it and saying, only allow me to paint in that space.
Yes, exactly.
That is so cool.
So yes, big time saver.
And now it makes sense to me why you're able to do this with these soft edged brushes with this anti-aliasing going on. Because what I was doing was I was using like the magic wand tool and selections with anti-aliasing off, which I think was probably what was throwing me off on my digital painting. Was it gave everything these really hard edges and made it look,
yes,
yeah, like it was cut out of construction paper and then painted on afterwards. But even if you cut it out of construction paper, there's going to be a softness to that line.
Yeah. And that's kind of, I mean, like I said, I had my start doing a lot of Illustrator stuff. And that's kind of the feeling I always had doing Illustrators. I just felt like, okay, I like this. I like kind of the process, but I didn't like the harshness of the line. And I wanted to find a way to kind of, get more, just get a little more texture in the stuff I was doing. So you can see now, so far what I've been doing is really not going too far away from how you would do something if you were toon shading something, right? I'm going in and kind of just adding in some really the hard shadows.
Yeah, this looks absolutely natural to me. I mean, this is something I could actually do.
Yeah. So
you've got your highlight color, or rather you've got your base tone, and now you've got a shadow color. And then for me, like the next thing I would do would be throw on like a light gradient for a highlight color.
Sure. Yeah. So I'm going to go on the neck now. I'm going to kind of dig in just another, I'm going to put another layer there, just add another kind of layer of darkness on the neck. So,
and again, you're using the clipping, no, what do you call it? Clipping layer?
Yeah, I think it's called a clipping layer. All right.
I think Dijusan told me about that one, of Gray is the webcomic. I think she mentioned that to me in an email recently. And I flagged it for follow-up, and I gotta start following links that people send me faster, because now I'm seeing it in action. I'm like, oh man, clipping mask is what Dijusan was saying. Yeah. Okay, so that's something different.
Okay, this is a little bit harsh, so I'm just gonna turn down the opacity on the shadow just under the neck.
Okay.
And then I'm gonna kind of strike in some of that same shadow on the ear. Now, one of the things about this kind of clipping layer is it doesn't nest. So if I create another clipping layer, I'm creating another clipping layer here. It's all gonna clip this. The head is gonna clip all these layers, as many layers as I kind of put on top of it. It'll clip, but it doesn't nest. So I can't have one layer being clipped by another layer being clipped by another layer.
Okay, so it every clipping layer you add above the source clipping layer will always respond to the source clipping layer.
The source clipping layer, yeah.
Gotcha.
Okay. Okay. So really, you could almost even that you could say, hey, this is you know, you could go that far and say, yeah, that's.
This is looking pretty good.
And maybe add a gradient. You could go in and, like you said, locker on right now. I got that red, and I can go even warmer with the red.
Oh, and you can still modify the colors of each of the source layers just by going to hue saturation too, can't you?
Yes.
Oh, wow. A lot of
so
versatility here.
If I want to make this even less kind of destructive, I can go in here, and I've created another clipping layer on top of this head, and I'm putting the gradient on on that layer, so I don't have to. It's not going to mess up what I do underneath.
Right. Oh, wow. So cool.
So got a little bit more warmth on there. I'm going to do another layer and kind of grab this yellow from the top and just kind of strike that into his nose too. So we got that.
So it's interesting to me that you start out with pretty stark differences in color.
Uh-huh.
I'm hoping that we don't have a whole lot of time left. I'm hoping that we can go into how you soften these transitions between these colors, because that's something in your portfolio.
Yeah.
I noticed a lot. Oh, there's how you
well,
do it.
Okay. That's one.
Yeah.
I'll show you more of what I do, though. Okay. So I'm gonna grab kind of some more textural brushes for this. You can do it with airbrush and stuff like that. I want to use something that's gonna give it a little more just texture as we do it. So this is kind of a custom brush I've made, but it's made out of the standard brush, like standard chalk brushes. So it just kind of has a little bit of texture to it. I can even go to my brush presets and let's see, it's kind of harsh, so I'm just gonna give it, I can either make it fade or, I'm just gonna give it the brush a little bit of opacity. No, I'm gonna have it fade out. Okay, I'll get that
So you
off.
change that in the brush dynamics,
Going into brush dynamics or
brush
just
presets.
brush.
Oh, just brush. Yeah, it's just called the brush palette now. Okay.
Yeah. That's brush presets there. So transfer, opacacity, I'm turning that to pen pressure. It's just going to give it a little bit of opacity.
So the harder you press with the pen, the more opaque it is. The lighter you press with the pen, the less opaque it
Yes.
is.
Yeah. So I'm then just going to go in and this out of the way.
Interesting.
And I try to do this stuff as much as possible. I even need to turn down the opacity on this a little bit.
So now you're just stroking out from the highlight into the base color of the face to create like a
Yes.
faded sense of light dissipating on the face.
Yeah.
And using like a chalky kind of brush that you just
Yes.
found from the stock brushes in Photoshop, right? Or is this one you made?
Yeah, it just from the stock ones in Photoshop, and then I just kind of adjusted it to what I wanted it to be. So, I mean, it's really like you don't need a lot of like fancy brushes to do what you want to do. You can kind of use what comes in Photoshop. I try to be as much as possible, keep with the idea of a la prima, you know. If you can go in and that's this kind of this idea that comes from John Singer Sargent, that just like you try to do one stroke to get across what you want. You know, and that's always going to make things look prettier rather than going over things over and over again, which sometimes you get going and that just kind of happens. But you know, the more you can hit it in one stroke, kind of the better you'll get kind of what you're looking for.
It's funny, I was just talking with the production guys about this just before we started recording about how this applies to inking. Like if you can achieve like six things with one line stroke. Then, like that's like something a lot of us artists aspire to, and it just
Yes.
and like to the casual reader, they don't pick up on it, but there's like a grace and an elegance to that that when you like really start to pay attention to stuff that. Okay, so now you're just on another layer, you're just going ahead and fading the shadows in with the same brush, just using a textured brush with the.
Yeah. Yeah, and
Interesting.
I'm honestly not totally happy with this, but it's kind of it's, you know, good enough to kind of explain what I'm doing.
It's good for a demo piece, and it's certainly superior to that mess that I was showing off earlier. So, now this answered a lot of questions for me, Brandon. That is really, really cool. So, you're going to lead a digital painting class for Lean Into Art sometime, right?
I would love to. That'd be
Or even
fantastic.
better yet, let's fly you out to Michigan to do a digital painting course at AADL.
Ooh, yes.
All right. Well, I want to move on quickly and spend a few minutes talking about this micropayment stuff and get started on that. Because I know if Eli is showing up today, I know he's got thoughts on it. So you got like, we
And
got.
it's okay if I keep painting while we do this.
Sure, of course. So we keep switching. We watch you paint while we talk about this thing. So you've got Green Monk, which we didn't mention at the top. Green Monk is a comic that you did, what, last year before?
Actually, 2009, actually. So it's
2009.
been a while. It's time for me to get off my butt.
Well, you've been working on the new book, but you got a lot of things on your plate. But anyway, so Green Monk is this book that was widely hailed as a very, very well done comic, and it's available at brandondayton.com. You were awarded. You made the list of the ALSA top 10 books that are great for or comics that are great for teens. Kind of a big deal. You're gonna win the Eisner next year, I'm sure. So you have it available on your site for sale using Bitcoin.
Yes.
Bitcoin. which, if anybody hasn't heard of it, it's at bitcoin.org, as we can find more information about it. There's a great podcast by Steve Gibson on the Twit Network. It's at twit.tv/SN287. That's Security Now, episode 287.
I've seen that one.
Yeah, Steve Gibson goes into a elaborate, long description of how Bitcoin works. And then you use Flatter on your site. And I also noticed recently that you're using uTippit on your site.
Yes, which is really similar to Flatter. It was just kind of started by some people who do Bitcoin. So it kind of has that Bitcoin, you know, basis to it. But now it takes PayPal and stuff now as well. So, of all those things, I mean, the thing that is most exciting to me, though, is Bitcoin. That's really the micropayment stuff is interesting, but I feel like Bitcoin is going to be the thing that's going to be the really kind of transformative technology. So that's kind of why I've been following that. And
let me just try to do my best to summarize it for folks who haven't heard of it yet. It's basically a digital currency. And okay, so what? We've got PayPal. Well, Bitcoin is a digital currency that doesn't actually go through any kind of clearinghouse or central agency that verifies and organizes the payments and who's paid what and who has how much money. This is somehow – it's distributed via peer-to-peer, if I understand it right?
Yes. So it's really interesting because the way it works is, you know, there's peer-to-peer stuff like BitTorrent or something like that. Yeah. The way that Bitcoin works is it's like those things, but instead of sharing like a movie file, everyone shares a little piece of the ledger. So, and that's the way that they keep it secure. And they have all some, you know, it gets technical into cryptography and stuff like that, but kind of by everyone kind of sharing a piece of the ledger, it keeps anyone from controlling and manipulating and changing, you know, and adding money in or taking money out. So it's I mean, the more you kind of like research and look into it, it's just this really brilliant, you know, system of keeping money secure without having some sort of central or, you know, a system or someone else doing that.
So well, that's the thing about things like Flatter or BitPass. Do you remember BitPass?
I think I've heard of that.
That was a few years back. Oh, maybe more than a few years back. But in any of these cases, it was like a system that you had to opt into. You had to sign up and give your credentials and associate like some kind of account with it, whether it's your bank account or PayPal account, in order to put money into the system. And I mean, that's how Flatter works. Flatter, I signed up for it just because I was curious based on seeing it on your site. And you sign up for an account and then you say, okay, I want to put this much money in my Flatter account and then distribute it amongst websites that I think are cool. But the interesting thing about Bitcoin, I think the big headline for me was, is that you don't actually have to, you know, associate any kind of like bank accounts or anything with the system. It's just you download an app. Is that right? You download an app and...
Yeah, you download an app. There's kind of a couple of interesting ways to do it now. But yeah, you download an app that's basically, they call it your wallet, and you keep your balance of Bitcoins there, and then you go to an exchange, and kind of the biggest exchange right now is one called Mt. Gox, and at that exchange you can exchange whatever currency they have. You know, international currencies, they have USD. You change your currency for Bitcoin. It's still growing. It's still a lot of new stuff being developed, and it's still kind of figuring its way out and figuring out how to be accessible and usable by kind of the common man. So there still is some risk associated with using it. So I would caution anyone that wanted to try it out that, you know, it's still kind of in its growing phase. It's kind of like the internet.
Oh, we lost your audio there for a second, Brandon. It's kind of like the internet. What? Brandon, are you there? Oh, we lost him. We lost Brandon. So then I will have to make some noise with my mouth for a minute while we wait to get him back. Oh, there he is.
Hey.
The IMF just shut you down. That's what people are saying.
They heard me talking about it, yeah.
Could you reactivate your video and we can just see your face now?
Want to do that?
Yeah, while we close out what the Bitcoin.
Sounds good.
But why are you so excited about this? Because, I mean, digital money, who cares? Nobody's going to use it.
Yeah, that could be the case. it kind of works the same way as, like, you know, what email did for what it did for communication. You know, it's just one of taking down another barrier that makes it easier for people to get their own business going and do their own thing. I mean, right now, currently, if you have two people using Bitcoin, it is the cheapest way to send someone money or transfer money. And so particularly if you're going international, it's the best way to transfer money internationally. But it's fantastic just because it's straight, it's person to person. You don't have to pay some sort of like fee like you would in PayPal if you're buying something. And there's a lot of people that are into anonymity and things like that. And if that's your bag, it has a lot of good protections for keeping your transactions anonymous, which is why it's kind of called digital cash. And it's used for a lot of illegal things too. So.
Which is what a lot of people in the articles that I was reading as much literature as I could about this over the last couple of months since you first contacted me about it. I got to ask, I'm sure people are wondering, have you made any sales via Bitcoin yet?
Can't say that I've had. I've had a couple of people. I've made some commissions available through Bitcoin and haven't had any bites on that. And my book is available on Bitcoin. It took me a while to find out a good system where I could accept Bitcoin on my website. And I finally found something that I'm happy with.
I didn't even think about that. Yeah, like what do you use to set up accepting payments?
Yeah, like I said, it's still so new that a lot of the solutions are you have to know a lot of programming to do. And I finally found one where you don't have to know any programming. It's called Bitcoin Evolution. And it's nice because what it does, you put your prices in USD or whatever currency you want to use, and it's going to update that price in Bitcoin according to the exchange rate. So and because Bitcoin is new, it's still kind of volatile in its price. So a lot of people right now in business are kind of using it as an intermediary, where they will make a transaction in Bitcoin and then immediately exchange it to USD, so that its value isn't changing a lot. And there's a lot of speculation going on with it too.
Well, and there's also this weird thing about how their answer to inflation is that it's mathematically worked out to where there can only be so many Bitcoins ever made. Like in
yes.
like 2 years, the final Bitcoin will be made. And there's a whole weird – and I don't want to go into all the details on this because I don't understand it all. And Steve Gibson's going to say it way better than I do. You mint Bitcoins through working out mathematical problems on your computer.
Uh-huh.
And that's how the first Bitcoins were mined, yes?
Yes. And that's still the case, and that kind of has the added feature of as Bitcoins are minted through computation, it also secures the network. So the computations that the computers do also hash all this information to keep people from getting all that secure information. So it's kind of brilliant in that sense. There's this incentive for people to secure the network.
So yeah, I'm going to encourage people to listen to if this sounds interesting to you, listen to Steve Gibson's podcast on Bitcoin. That's at twit.tv/SN287, which will be in the show notes. But I want to ask you, Brandon, I mean, isn't there a little bit of a chicken or egg thing going on here where we've got, okay, we want to start accepting digital money. That would be really convenient for us and the users. Boy, wouldn't it be great if you could just like use digital money to buy PDFs for your iPad or to be read on your desktop or even like you've got the flatter buttons. Like, did I make you happy today? You can tip me. You can tip me for this thing. And then you don't have to go through a PayPal button where there's like a whole, oh, let's launch a whole page and I got to log into your PayPal.
Yeah.
You sure you want to send this money? Yes, I'm sure. Do you want to say anything special to Brandon when you send him this money? No, just send him the darn money. Just give him the money. You know, if you had to go through that every time you were in Facebook, the tip jar at a Starbucks, you would never use it. So I totally get this idea that if the threshold between tipping somebody for their digital content was very, very limited, then more people would probably do it. I think that more and more people are becoming aware of that this all this content that's being distributed online has a value of some sort. Eli, you can come on in and join us on that because I know you've got thoughts on this.
because it's easy to make a transfer, you can just very easily say, hey, I'm going to give you 0.1 Bitcoin for this, and just boom, you're done. And no transaction fee. I mean, it's not like using PayPal or a credit card where it's like for every payment I make, I got to think about this like fee. It's like I make a – especially for a merchant, it's like I don't want to accept a buck. I mean, if I accept a buck, I'm going to have to pay this huge fee out to a credit card company just to take a buck.
When you go to some small towns, you go to some like smaller areas, you have that situation where it's like you got to spend at least $7 if you want to use your debit card, right?
Yeah.
So I want to introduce Eli Nyberger of the Ann Arbor District Library, who's here to do some book recommendations in a minute. But I also wanted to give you a chance to weigh in on this digital currency stuff. And you got that pained look of, I'm going to say stuff that is going to come across as one way, but I don't mean it that way.
Well. Bitcoin has enormous potential, and I didn't hear all your conversation over the past 15 minutes or so, but you know, there's a lot of things right about Bitcoin. Mm-hmm. However, it's a liquid currency. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? And it is a currency that is liquid on a scale that no currency has ever been liquid before. And if you watch, I mean, the last thing that you want to do, especially as a creator, is get some income via this format and then find out that it's worth a tenth of what it was the day before. Mm-hmm. You know, so there's some, you know, if it matures and becomes a currency that has some stability to it, that's great. At this point, I think that it's primarily as a currency too attractive to speculators. Because, you know, people see, hey, man, I can mine some bitcoins and then, you know, the next day they're going to be worth twice. And it's like that sort of, you know, oh, you can make a killing. You know, that attitude brings the worst elements in human society into the monetary pool. Right.
Yeah.
And then and it makes for a very volatile currency market, which as a creator is probably not the way.
No.
You want to be looking at it.
Now, Brandon, are you doing any Bitcoin mining? Because I understand, as far as the literature I've read, is that you basically need a supercomputer now to do it because it's so complex as more and more hashes are made, as more and more Bitcoin chains are made, you need more powerful computers, and it's actually not it's not cost effective anymore, the amount of energy you use, right?
Yeah, for most people most people's computers, it's not worth doing just because your computer is not. It's going to take you like 5 years to mine a Bitcoin, and so you do need to have a very powerful computer. And primarily, you need to have a computer with a specific type of video card and a very powerful video card. So, and my Mac happens to have, I think is it I'm trying to remember if it's NVIDIA that does the cards that work really well, or I can't remember. But my Mac does have the correct card. I'm going to have to look at this. And so I've played around with mining, and you can join up with a pool. And the way that works is rather than waiting 5 years to mine a coin, you join a pool that has, you know, hundreds of thousands of other people mining. And anytime there's a block discovered, that's when you get your payout. You get kind of a cut of that. Mm-hmm. So I've done that, and according to my computing power, I get like a percentage of what it is. But, you know, even with a Mac with the highest-end video card, I'll get like, you know, 0.01 Bitcoin every, you know, 3 days. So, you know, it's kind of it's fun to play with, but, you know, you're not going to make loads of money, you know, on your personal computer mining Bitcoin. If you're really interested in trying it out, it's going through an exchange is probably the way to do it. So.
But the challenge with that is that you've now provided, and I'm not saying you, the world has now provided an economic incentive to develop technology to solve a specific type of encryption problem. Mm. You know, and it just so happens that this one NVIDIA card, because it's massively parallel, is very good at it.
Yeah.
But if you've created an economic incentive that gives the appearance of free, unlimited money, and all you have to do is solve this computer science problem.
Yeah.
That makes the entire currency pool subject to all of a sudden someone announces a brand new hardware device that's, you know, that they were able to hack together from a couple of off-the-shelf things, and it can find a Bitcoin every day. And, you know, now that's far-fetched, but if you would have told 13-year-old me how many more times powerful than my bar mitzvah computer my later telephone would be, I would not have believed you. So I think it's important to put the resources that are coming into that network within the perspective of that, you know, that's a monetary world that can be shaken up at a moment's notice.
Yeah, and there's definitely a lot of people trying to game that system because they know that. They know, hey, if we can manipulate this, there's a big payoff. I mean, one thing I would say is the algorithm is set up in such a way that my understanding is that the difficulty, the faster people mine or the more successful people are at mining, the difficulty kind of amps up.
Yeah.
So, it's
It's like low-hanging fruit going further up the tree.
Yeah, it's a tricky challenge as far as just amping up computational power. But, yeah, it is an issue. But, again, it kind of – the trade-off is that people that do want to spend that time and money figuring out how to, you know, mine Bitcoin are also just going to work to make the network more secure. So, I don't know. It's interesting. Like, I agree with you that it's still very – it's early on. And so because it's early on, there's that volatility to think about. You know, if you put money in there, you don't know. The value is going to be up and down. I will say in my experience that that the price kind of in general will stay in stable areas for pretty good amount of time, and then we'll have little moments of volatility. So I would recommend if someone wanted to use it, wanted to try – making money with it, that they set it up as an intermediary where you use Bitcoin to kind of transfer value back and forth, and then convert it immediately to you know, the dollar amount. So,
and I guess a part of it is that, you know, I look at it much the same way that I looked at Second Life, you know, which libraries basically fell all over themselves to get into, only to discover there's nobody there. You know, and one of the things, I mean, I don't have any question that the future of money looks a lot more like Bitcoin than it does like what we're carrying in our wallets. Mm-hmm. Similarly, you knew that when you were looking at Second Life, there's a future that's going to look like this.
Yes.
Is this the platform of the future? Almost definitely not.
Mm-hmm.
You know, but this is a precursor. You know, this is like, you know, in the Starfleet terms, this would be like the replicator that could only make toothpaste, you know?
Yeah, yeah.
You know, it's not even version 1.0.
Thanks for bringing it back to our language.
So is there going to be like, you know, another technology that's very similar that's going to do it better and can be more widely accepted?
Yeah, especially if it gets someone behind it who also has credibility in the financial world.
Yeah.
Because right now, you know, the entire financial world is looking at Bitcoin and laughing its bloated ass off.
Yeah.
You know, so now I think we can guess in these sorts of stories who has the last laugh.
Mm-hmm.
But at the same time, it's like there needs to be, you know, a currency that isn't taken seriously isn't much of a currency. And, you know,
sure.
And right now, only forward-thinking people who can see the potential are taking it seriously.
Mm.
Well, that and speculators, you know,
is it,
and not to be trusted.
Is the hacker group anonymous using Bitcoin?
Well, the challenge
Probably.
Is Bitcoin really isn't all that anonymous.
Mm.
You know, every transaction is publicly knowable by everybody.
Right.
You know, so it's not as anonymous as cash.
Yeah.
You know,
there are additional steps. If you really want to use it anonymously, there's additional steps you need to go through to kind of make sure, you know, you can't be tracked. But yeah, there's a record of every single transaction of you know, addresses, and so people can go back and see, you know, where money's being spent and so forth.
I want to close out this discussion with one thought on this thing, is that every time one of these new technologies comes along, BitPass, before that, there were some other ones, I forget what they were. BitPass was the one McCloud.
Oh yeah, I used BitPass for a while.
I got an account the moment it came out, because I remember with Scott McCloud behind it, I was like, oh, it's here.
Right.
Micropayments is here, finally. And then every time one of those things falls apart, this huge Greek chorus comes in, micropayments are dead. You know, never going to happen. It's never going to work. Nobody wants to pay a penny for something. I wonder if you guys could weigh in on, do you think that this is – the fact that it keeps coming back again and again, is this people trying to solve a problem that doesn't exist, or is it a reflection of the fact that eventually we'll get there to where we're going to be able to just tip effortlessly?
I think actually it's a reflection of the fact that bits are inherently worthless.
Mm.
And people aren't willing to pay real money for real bits, you know, because all you know, you're changing the state of some bits of metal inside your computer.
Mm-hmm.
And that doesn't have the same that does not have an economic value that can be equated in lattes. You know what I mean? So I think as a result, a lot of people say micropayments are dead. Well, what the hell is the App Store? You know, App Store is the most successful micropayment system
mm-hmm.
ever. But the most interesting thing about it is that the people who are making the most money on the App Store are giving their product away for free, you know, and making the money, the real money on the horse armor and all the add-ons. Again, like we've always been talking about, it's not about selling access. It's about monetizing your audience.
Yeah.
And
that's really what the whole Facebook, ecosystem is all about. So that probably would have been a good discussion after having worked on a Facebook game for over a year.
Well, having
it's absolutely brilliant. It's more about bringing people into the marketplace. You let them enter the marketplace for free, and then there's all sorts of things that they can purchase at, you know, small amounts. But the highest – the people spending the most money on Facebook games spend, you know, thousands, tens of thousands, and more. So there's a big if you can set up the system right, there's a big market for those small micropayments. Just figuring out how to do it with comics. If you can figure out how to do that with comics, there's a big future there.
Well, I think that part of the problem is that creators tend to say, okay, micropayments, let's do this. You can buy a panel at a time or a strip at a time or a page at a time. And it's like that's not really the saleable unit, you know, and you need to be selling the stuff to your super fans. And that because that you're if you're trying to get the price point down to the point where someone who's not a fan will pay, you'll never get low enough because they can just click over to 2 billion other places on the web and get something entertaining for free. You got to get to the point where you have a value that appeals to your beginning fans. You know, it's like, oh, I'm kind of into this guy. I'm going to throw him a buck and unlock the commentary track on this month's comics or whatever you decide to upsell. Mm-hmm. But I think that part of the problem is just because so many cartoonists are still looking at the diamond distribution model as the way that people make it in comics. They think, oh, I got to sell my books. You know, and it's like, well, that's not, you know, that's not necessarily the part that the beginning fan wants to pay for.
Yeah, I think... Correct me if I'm wrong. I'm going to try to summarize your point of view on this as best I can. Is that you're talking about micropayments break down the moment we try to apply it to a 20th century model of, hey, this ain't a library. You can't look for free. Come back, come back in when you got money, and then you can actually see the thing. I'm not going to put my whole comic on my set. I'll put three panels. Right. Or one guy suggested to me that, hey, you know, it'd be a really great marketing move is put this book in its entirety on the BitTorrents, let it get passed around, but then have that last page not be the ending, but be a lecture about stealing things, about stealing, you know, internet piracy. And I thought, oh, wow, that's not going to make people happy. That's just going to make them mad at us. They're not going to want to buy our book then, you know?
Well, I think you take out the lecture and you got yourself a business model.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, it's like the last page is just like, well, you know, I think that we will see ebooks that are free except for the last chapter.
You think so?
Yeah, absolutely. Because why wouldn't you? You know, you got them at that point. And you know that's your value add is the denouement. You know, I mean that's
what happens after.
That's right.
I think the real trick with comic creators is finding the micropayment stuff, the little things you buy in Facebook. The trick with comic creators is finding something that they can create that's of value to their fans that doesn't take the comic creators too much resources to produce.
Yeah,
right.
And that may sound lazy, but especially if you're giving away a book for free, you need to find something that you can give to the fans that is of a great value to them, but doesn't cost you a ton of resources to produce. And that's so far a lot of what people are doing is, well, I've created this book and then I'm giving away this other extra thing, but this other extra thing is incredibly time consuming to produce too.
Yeah.
You know? And so it's finding those things that can add value without, you know, breaking the bank for the creator.
And the other part of it is I think establishing a less commercial relationship with your fans, where it's like, you know, your fans aren't so much asking them, pay for this because this thing has the value that I'm asking for it. Mm-hmm. Pay for this so I can keep doing work, and here's your premium for supporting me as an artist.
The PBS model.
The PBS model, exactly.
Yeah.
You know, and the only thing is that, you know, then you got to interrupt the programming. Stand by with a special message. Yeah. Dude, we interrupt Ken Burns again.
I have this dream of doing like a telethon kind of idea. I was just talking with Ryan Estrada of RyanEstrada.com about this the other day of a band of creators get together and they decide to do like seven cartoonists, like a rock band, decide we're going to do an 80-page story. And we're going to stream it on the internet live and we're going to work for 4 days straight and just broadcast the entire process. And over this time, like, we could have, like, a telethon meter. Like, you know, keep these guys going.
Donations. Yeah.
Yeah. You have a donation thing going. And then the entertainment is watching us crack up as we all, on Skype, try to build a comic from scratch, a bunch of guys. I think that would be so much fun to do. But also, we're probably really damaging to our health. But anyway, I want to wrap this up. We got book recommendations to do and then news to do. So, what did you bring for us, Eli?
Oh, I brought a couple different things. Not hugely tied into what we were talking about, but just pulled a couple things off the shelf. The first is, let me get this This is called Nobody in Particular, One Woman's Fight to Save the Bays by Molly Bang. This is in our teen section, and it's a, you know, it's a nonfiction comic about a true story about a shrimper who discovered some pollution and went, you know, it's kind of like an Aaron Brockovich kind of tale. Mm. What I really like about this is there's clearly a huge amount of labor in this work, and it's a really interesting combination of these pretty clearly non-digital paintings and non-digital illustrations, but then mixed in with some, you know, kind of Xerox tech compositing. Let me see if I got that view in there. And so, you know, it does a really nice job of setting this story of the human stuff against the natural world and just kind of saying what goes on with it. So, you know, it's got the bonus of that it's nonfiction. So you've learned something about a pretty interesting story here. And it was really unique and visually appealing. So that was one thing, and that's called Nobody Particular by Molly Bang. Then I brought something, and I've highlighted this author's, the editor of this. This is called Stuck in the Middle. This is 17 comics from an unpleasant age, so it's about middle and high school. And this is edited by Ariel Schrag, who also did a four-book series I brought on once before, Awkward, Definition, Likewise, and Potential. These were the comics that she actually drew when she was an angsty coming-out teenager in Berkeley. And yeah, man, it's like, boy, for Midwesterners, it's like, so that's how teenagers live in Berkeley. Boy, is that, you know, anyway. So this has got stuff from a bunch of different artists, including some really big name. We got Daniel Klaus. This is a really cool story called Like a Weed Joe. Very much in his style. Here's something Cole Johnston's got, kind of a unique, sparse thing.
I'm glad that you're bringing in an anthology, Eli, because I was just talking with some folks on Twitter the other day. As a matter of fact, it was Demophon, who was on the show a couple weeks ago, about how it seems like only artists are the ones who get excited about anthologies, but you rarely hear, like, in the publishing industry, they say, oh, anthologies are death. And, right. And there's a few breakout hits, like the Flight Anthology, but rarely do you see anthologies being celebrated. So it doesn't bother you as a reader to open
No, up. I love it. Jeez. I mean, because it's like each one of these, I'm like, well, I want to read more by that person.
Yeah.
I don't want to read more by that person. You know, that kind of stuff. Yeah. So, I mean, and especially when there's something that has a very tight theme where it's a bunch of stories that are really closely related. I love seeing different artists take on a similar sort of thing, especially because so many of these are kind of personal stories. Mm-hmm. And then there's also kind of the reverse, where you've got an anthology of different stories all done by one artist. A thing that comes to mind is the Jesse Reklaw's Dreams stuff. And then there's I don't remember off the top of my head. There's also an anthology of stories inspired by Craigslist misconnections postings. gosh, I can't remember what that's called. I'm sure Eric will dig it up. But, you know, I think I can understand from a market position when you're looking at names and you're like, well, what the hell is this? Who the hell is this? But I think as a reader, I love looking at that stuff, especially because, you know, you can always bail on it if it gets not interesting, or skip ahead to the next story or any of that kind of stuff. And it's not that different from the Big Book of series, which I've brought on a couple times, like the Big Book of Hoaxes, the Big Book of, because each one of those has got, it's a very rigid format. It's all written by one guy, but he's got different artists working on each story. And it's just such a fun and unique way to go through some pretty heavy content. Then I brought one more thing that I think probably a lot of people are aware of, but just in case, this is Granville by Brian Talbot. And speaking of Second Life, this is like the furry's ultimate dream. This is furry steampunk noir murder mystery Victorian. So,
Oh my gosh.
There's all kinds of stuff. This looks to me like it is pretty clearly digitally painted.
Yes, it is.
Maybe on top of hand-drawn inks, but I'm not sure
about
the inks. But you can see there's lots of blur effects and lots of gradients that humans can't really do.
Yeah.
and, you know, it's a very cool story. One of the things I like the most about it is there are humans in it, and the humans are like the subjugate species. I think they call them dough faces. let me see this. I think here in the hotel, they come across a busboy. Oh, here, look, right up in this panel. Let me see if I can get that a little closer to the camera. You can see two washing women are actual humans. So it's like the world is ruled by the badgers and the marsupials, and, you know, but they can still, you know, the humans are like the lesser species. But it's a fantastic story, got really interesting kind of, they refer to an event in this story that's kind of like their 9/11. Like there was a big explosion that some French separatist groundhogs pulled off, and you know, so, and then this is his Watson friend is like a dormouse. So this is super great. There's a sequel to it called Granville Mon Amour. It's just super great stuff. This is Brian Talbot is the artist, and the character's name is Detective Inspector LeBrock of Scotland Yard. And he's a very badass badger. He's huge.
Just so what publisher?
This is Dark Horse.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Cool so, cover, too. It's like yeah. the library binding.
Yes, library binding. And it's got these end papers that he designed to have governors and gears and all that kind of stuff.
Super so cool.
I'm a big fan of Granville. Super great stuff.
Okay, well, I had one thing that I wanted to throw out while we're on the topic of books. I'm going to hold this up for the camera. This is Nemu Nemu. They were on the show not too long
hold
ago.
Oh,
yeah,
the...
we do. There we go. We can do it there. They have a holiday sale going on right now where you can get plushies with the books, plushies of the characters of the books, which I think is a dynamite idea. This is a comic. Let me just describe if you haven't heard of this comic. It is the middle ground between Calvin and Hobbes and Richard Scarry's Busy Town. It has a little bit of both of that in it, and it's one of the finest comics on the internet. I also wanted to make a point out of their Kickstarter campaign. They were holding a Kickstarter campaign to publish their new book, and that's at nemu-nemu.com. You can find a link to the Kickstarter campaign. It's a worthy cause. They're one of the finest comics on the internet. They deserve our support. I pitched in, and I hope you guys will consider doing so too. But also, it's just a great comic. And they're going to be speaking at the Ann Arbor District Library in February over Skype for the Comics Artist Forum. And then I also want to make one more last. This is where we get
do you have guest work in here, Jerzy? This said,
yeah, I do.
I'm looking for
it. It's early on.
Oh, okay.
It's like I've been in almost every one of their collections.
Awesome.
Ann and I did a Halloween strip where the pups learn about how to do trick-or-treating.
Cool.
But yes, okay, so we got some news going on. Registration is now open for a three-session workshop online at leanintoart.com. I'm going to be doing a soup-to-nuts comprehensive approach to lettering in Adobe Illustrator. The workshop is called FATAM, Designing Sound of Elements in Adobe Illustrator. Three sessions, and that's at leanintoart.com. Tomorrow...
call it Snicked?
Snicked.
You had the opportunity and you...
FATAM was one of mine. It was one where a reviewer was commenting on my work saying he's got plenty of those old corny sound effects. He even made up some of his own, like FATAM.
Oh, okay. So, gotcha. You got to own it at that point. Yeah.
Yeah, so it's like my brand. That's my Snicked is FATAM. Zorch and Thadish are also two of my go-tos. But yeah, it's gonna be a long workshop about sound effect theory. Brandon knows I've spent... I did a 2-hour podcast once on sound effect design. It's one of my favorite subjects. But anyway, so it'll be a fun class. I'm going to be very excited about that one. That's going to be on January 7th, 11th, 14th is when the classes are going to happen, but registration is open now. So anyway, then tomorrow, at the time of this recording, December 8th is the Make the Comics Drink and Draw at Roos Roast in Ann Arbor, Michigan, and that's at comicsaregreat.com/MTC is where you can find more information about that, or makethecomics.com if your memory's short. But I hope to see you guys there. I hope anybody who's in the area will come out. We got some Ann Arbor District librarians coming out to the event.
I hope so. Awesome.
Yeah. Ann's going to be there and Sharon Iverson confirmed. So excellent. We got one of the local dons of the Ann Arbor comic scene there. And then there's going to be the comics visual storytelling exhibit at Mallet's Creek. Thank you guys for giving us that opportunity.
I'm looking forward to seeing it.
Yeah, we're going to put up a show of comics art at Mallet's Creek for a month or so. And then January 8th, we have the Comics Artist Forum. Rob Stenzinger of interactive-storyteller.com is going to be doing a artist visit, doing a talk on writing gag comics. And that's going to be right here on the fourth floor in the downtown Ann Arbor District Library. So that was all the news I had. Anything that you wanted to point people at, Elaine?
Just if we have anyone who's been following our treasure quest at play.aadl.org, a new key dropped this week. And for those of you that might be fans of Ian M. Banks' The Culture Series, it's all about the culture novels. So, And if you haven't read The Culture Series and you're into sci-fi, there's some of the finest sci-fi novels ever written, I think.
Super cool. That's play.aadl.org.
Yep.
Okay, and Brandon, I'll give you a chance. Anything that you want to point people at? Anything that you're excited about that you're doing right now?
Yeah, I guess just keep your eyes on Facebook. Look for that game coming out pretty soon. It's going to be called Risk Factions, and that's it for me right now. I'll have some other things going on probably next year. So.
Oh, yeah, okay. Well, thank you for being on the show, Brandon. It's BrandonDayton.com, Brandon Dayton on Twitter, Brandon Dayton on Facebook, Facebook too, and Google Plus, right? Same name everywhere, right?
Yes, yeah.
So, cool. Well, thanks for this awesome class on digital painting today, Brandon. I really appreciate it.
That was fun.
And Eli is at aadl.org, Ulotricus on the Twitters, and Ulotricus online, ulo.com. Trico.us.
That's right.
Ah, I got it. And you can look for him on YouTube. There's lots and lots of Eli talking in videos on YouTube talking about how libraries are screwed. But he has the answer.
Yes, sir.
So thanks, Eli, and thanks to the Ann Arbor District Library for putting on this show every week. This will be live next week at 12:30 p.m. Eastern Time, and then we're going to be off for 2 weeks for the holiday season, but we'll resume broadcasting in January. So until next time, everybody, thanks for downloading and listening. I've been Jerzy Drozd of ComicsAreGreat.com and Jerzy on Twitter. Okay, bye.